Hello, I believe we are live in living color today. And welcome, phone bless, tennis Jesus. We are here on a Sunday.
Amen.
For Reals Tennis Podcast Live, number 17. I'm telling you, church on Wimbledon 2015, Middle Sunday. And ladies, we're going to have the best time today. I'm telling you, there is so much to talk about. I don't even know where to begin. I mean, there's just so much. It's almost like tennis world. I mean, we could have a podcast every day with a brand new story, don't you think so? Because every day tennis just drops some crazy bombs, and it's just like out of control. Sometimes I'm just like, why? This
We're
is
just gonna start then. So let's
okay.
go.
Let's go, ladies.
Are we
So,
gonna introduce ourselves today?
thank you. We never think to do that.
This Sunday morning might be a tough road for you, huh? Let's all go.
Let's go. Let's go. We're gonna start off with lovely and always our. She used to be spiritual, but now she's in love with us, flesh every week. Our very own solely tennis travels, Andre. And
Hello.
then we have, Janina live coming from that wonderful state of Ohio. And as always, bridge free overhead spin, Karen bringing it in to us from the Cayman Caribbean. And I'm Reels live and direct from New York City, I think. Currently, Andre, and I don't travel, so I guess I'm always in New York City, right? But let's go, ladies. So, the first week of Wimbledon, we have one viewer, just so you know. So, we're going to
No,
be on
that's
our best
nice.
behavior. First
We're
viewer, hey, whoever you
gonna
are.
thank
And hopefully that number, those numbers go up. But anyway, so Wimbledon 2015, the first week. I'm just gonna put.
Well.
I'm just gonna say, you know what? Surprising as it is, then I'm not surprised by a lot of the shit that I saw happening. You were. I mean, in our hearts, in our deepest of hearts, we knew a lot of the shit that was gonna happen. Isn't really surprising. We are shocked, yes, it's true. But when you really sit down and think about it, it's not really surprising. And you know what? We're a feminist podcast, so we're gonna go with the ladies today. Because last week we went with the men, equality, ladies. So, ladies, the biggest shock for you.
The biggest shock. I mean, you know what? It's not even, let me just start by, it's not even a result because all the results of all the upsets are not really upsets in our minds, right? But I say
Amen.
the
Say.
biggest shock was Heather Watson and how close she came to taking out Serena. Where has that game been? Is this why people thought Heather Watson was a thing? And if this is what Heather Watson is capable of, why isn't she delivering this weekly? And that's
Except
my,
that robot.
yeah, that's my
You
own,
know
that's the
what,
shock.
Janina? It reminded me as to why the head-to-head was so lopsided this close, even.
I mean, I was just like, as a girl, like, what is this?
The match itself was the shock. The result, not so much because, and I said this to someone else online. I said, listen, if this was a young Williams sister, they would have won that match. But because this is typically how these matches tend to go, two breaks and then a third break to serve for it. And this week, we still expect to see Serena versus Venus. So there we go.
It's true, but you know what was interesting is Serena herself said she was making other plans. She thought she was done. She fights, and we know she fights, and you know better than to never count her out. But she's like, I was thinking about what I'm gonna go do.
I was about to go dancing. I was gonna take a dance class and watch Venus play,
And I'm
which.
gonna be back on Monday to watch Venus match.
Yep. So yeah, it was, but I mean, you know what? That was a shocker, and it was a fun match to watch, and it was good times. But for me, I'm like, what the fuck is Coco Vandeweghe doing giving Stozer a bagel?
Oh, no.
That
Take that back.
was a shocker.
Take that back. Take that back. She gives Caesar a double bagel. A double bagel. Let's be fair now. Let's be fair because I am about to go off on Sam Stoza. Girl, what the fuck is wrong with you? You know what? You're going to get the first thing. This is bullshit. Sam Stoza, you are
Wait.
No. I am being probably too frank, Sam Stoza. Sam Stoza was up 2-love and had break points to go up 3-love, double break. All of a sudden, Sam Stoza wasn't about this life. She wasn't about tennis. She wasn't about playing. She let Coco Vandeweghe win 12 straight games.
She won 12 straight games? See, I didn't get to see it. I didn't know that. I didn't realize there were 12. What the fuck? No. Was she hurt?
No.
Her brain was she was high?
Unacceptable. Unacceptable, Sam. We're not here for this. All your fans. You let down your fans. I mean, like, I know the biggest news out of Australian tennis is Bernard Tomic, but your ass should have been raked over the coals by Tennis Australia. They need to send you somewhere. You need to be immigrated somewhere.
No! Stop it! Voice of reason. Voice of reason, Karen. Please come
no,
in.
No. You have to understand something.
School Miss Karen.
I'm sure there are her fans out there who will correct me. But Stoza has never won a title on grass.
That's fine. But she was playing Coco Vandeweghe.
No. Coco plays a kind of game that
Coco is schizophrenic. She plays schizophrenic tennis.
It's a matchup issue.
Yes,
Coco can belt the ball.
Yes, she can.
And Coco can belt the ball, and you know, people think attacking Stoza's backhand is the way to play her. No. It's hitting deep to the forehand, which is what Coco did.
Because it always flies.
The ball is coming to her quicker than she has time to do that tape back and put on that top spin. Coco is 6 feet something.
Yep.
And she hits the shit out of that ball.
I feel like that shouldn't have happened.
Her movement. Her movement and backhand have improved. She's an incredible athlete. She's not going to get to the point of a Serena or a Venus or, you know, or Halep or any of those players who move comfortably. But if she gets in position and has enough time, she will hit your ass off the court.
And also,
we always have to remember that about Sam. We always have to remember that about Sam because as much as people talk about Sam's serves, they're fairly predictable.
They have absolutely no variety to them.
Look, I am not mad at Coco Wan, okay? That's not my issue. I'm not even mad at that because you know what, Coco, you're due for some good results, okay? I've been seeing and hearing about them. I'm surprised you're like 22 or 23. But you know what, Sam Stoza, you lost 12 straight games in a row. Look at yourself. Okay? Think of your life. Think of your choices. This is all I know.
Yeah. You better, girl. Okay. All right. I'm over her. Let's fuck it.
Moving on. Oh, I don't even want to bring this up because I know it's going to hurt Karen. Your number two pick? Yes. Simona Halep. Again.
I guess we have to
because she is the number three seed, don't she?
Is that your shock as well, Reels? Because we didn't hear Karen's shock. What was your shock, Karen?
My shock is Makarova going out to Rybakova.
That is true. I thought that was Money in the Bank. I thought Katarina has been in the second week of major since last year, Wimbledon. She made two semifinals.
She made the semifinals of the U.S. Open.
Exactly.
Finals of the Australian Open. And you get beat on a surface that rewards your game by somebody who's known for the City Open?
Wait a minute. You can't be insulting the City Open. The City Open is a lovely tournament. I hope I plan to be there.
But that's the only time Rybakova shows up to play tennis.
It is true. I have seen her there. But you know what? So I didn't see the match, but I have seen Rybakova, so that means that Rybakova hit it with the low slice, right? Because that's what she did.
I mean, she backhand sliced her to death.
Of course.
But she was coming forward a lot. But then she goes out and she loses to Victoria Azarenka 1.1.
Are you saying an Olga game?
is known. I mean, she is really loud. You know, I don't go in on the ladies about the screaming, but she was super, super.
Okay, that's an interesting shock for you though, Karen.
That was a shock for me.
Oh, interesting.
For me, God, I thought I had it right in my head and then it just slipped right out. These things happen.
I think you delivered it already. Your shock was Sosa.
Actually, I'm not mad at Sosa loss. I knew she would lose. I'm just mad at the way she lost. That wasn't the shocker for me. But I think the shocker for me is the fact that Zanira Diaz is in the foot rung of Wimbledon.
Hey, I think it's because she looked good at the player party.
Oh, God. That's not going to be our theory going forward.
It could be my theory, Andrew. Take it away.
I went back and looked at my draw sheet. I have Zarina Diaz into the second week.
Why I didn't? Because I thought that Flavia would wake up this week and decide that this was the week she was going to play tennis. I thought she was going to have like an Indian Wells week. You know how Flavia sometimes
because
talks.
I thought she was going to make, no, it's going to be Fabio's turn to sit in the stands and watch her. But I thought she was going to stick around this week. But Flavia wasn't about that life. And I said, Andrea Petkovic, girl, this is your shot. This is it. This is it.
Wow.
Your name coming. And then, no, Andrea Petkovic was about crying on court. That was, she cried on court.
What was that? Hay fever?
She cry on court.
Hay fever, I think it was.
It was losing.
Whatever.
Oh, but you know what? Say what you will about Diaz, but she is like the slow and steady girl. Like, yes. I mean, slow and steady young lady. Let's call her young ladies. I know people get offended by girls, which I personally like because it's quite lighthearted. But anyway, I think that Diaz is, you know what? She is always going to be around. You know, if there's a moment when a seed falters, Diaz is very steady. And then, of course, like a Ferrer, she'll be stomped by like a top three or top four. But so that means that she's up for a Pova mauling, do we believe?
Well, I tell you something.
Yes, of course. I mean, there's no doubt about it.
If people out there are planning to go to the Pova Diaz match, you're going to be out there for some time.
She's going to get those balls going, right?
These are two of the slowest players to ever play tennis.
Ever.
It's going to be a marathon. It will be epic, but it will be a marathon.
It will be a marathon, and not because it's the games are going to go fast. It's because both women take so damn long to throw the ball up in the air for serve.
Well, hey, whatever. I mean, are you all surprised about JJ?
No. Who is he?
Yes, I am.
Actually, you know what?
I'm semi-surprised. I mean, we all know what she's capable of, and I'm happy to see that she is where she is. So, yeah, I'm just kind of semi-surprised. Kvitova, we know, can, you know, lose to anybody at any given day or beat anybody on any given day. So it's like, it's a surprise, but it's not a surprise.
That's what I'm saying. All the upsets thus far, even the upset of poor Simona Halep, it's not that shocking because we know that it's not so much even their opponent. I mean, that's the thing, right? Because it's like, it's with JJ. Yes, we know JJ is talented. She has an all-around game. She's solid overall, and she doesn't make that much of penetration on grass. But, you know, but if she was going to outsteady anyone, wouldn't it be Kvitova for real?
That's the one moment. When the match started, I was about to tweet. I was about to say, JJ, girl, your mission today, don't get double bagel or breadstick by Kvitova. She is looking that good.
But I mean, Kvitova.
Well, she was. She was.
She was looking that good until she wasn't. Because, you know, Petra, when she misses, she's not missing by inches. She's missing by yards. I mean, no spin on the ball. I mean, Petra is going for the line person. She is missing by a country mile. And when the second set started and she started missing like that, I was like, JJ has a shot. It wasn't even when she had that break, I was like, JJ has a shot. Because it was the same thing I saw in the French Open against Baczynski. She started missing and missing wide, and then Petra just couldn't rein it in. Petra didn't have a middle game. She didn't know how to, like,
Petra
not go for broke.
She's not been challenged yet, and then all of a sudden she's being challenged. I mean, she was just fucking running through everybody.
But you know what it is, too, though? I think it's always important that if Petra is going off and she's playing, like, another big hitter or power player, she can maybe get herself through that match because maybe the other player will also hit big and go wild. But once you're playing someone with a little bit more, as Brad Gilbert would say, guile, which I think Tamina has, and I also think JJ has, they can sort of recognize that and just and go for the safety ball for them. They're not going to start competing with her by trying to out-hit her. They simply get the ball in court
And make her play.
Self-destruct a little bit.
Because in the second set, which JJ won, JJ only had two errors. Two errors for the entire set.
Those are Wozniackian numbers.
Exactly. Wozniackian.
And, you know, JJ does have that backhand, and she's fit. She was willing to run. She was fit this time around.
Oh, my God. No problem. You know, the tennis player is still showing that 2004 Wimbledon match.
Well, because they're going through all of Serena's matches, right? I thought they were. Weren't they going through her matches today? All finals.
They're interviewing Sharapova.
Listen.
And that's the clip that they showed.
They love that. They want that moment. They want that moment.
Good luck.
That's like drugs.
I don't know if you're going to get that moment.
You know what it is, though? You know why it's legitimately like drugs? I mean, aside from the fact that it's Sharapova, and like if you're going to make a breakthrough and beat somebody, beating Serena is guaranteed to keep you in the conversation always.
Sam, we're looking at you, Sam.
And we're still talking about you, girl.
But you know what? Because we all recognize that everyone can compete with Serena up to a point, and then they pull a Heather Watson. You know what I mean? So it's miraculous when a person gets over themselves enough to win the match.
What did Heather Watson have to say for herself? Did she get lost in the moment? Did she feel like she choked? I mean, did she admit to any of that?
No, I mean, she
basically said was that when Serena just elevated
her game. But she also admitted that she wasn't grateful about it, too. You know how some people are grateful to compete well with Serena? She knew that.
If
you're going to go places, you should win from two breaks up.
Because
unlike the other girls, like.
And the worst part about it is that she had
Safarova.
Yeah. She had help. Yeah,
she had what? How many people does Sandra Cord hold? She had
all of Australia, all of England, all of the Hill
Islands, all of Guernsey.
Heather got fucked up when Serena waved that finger and said, "Don't try me."
No, you know what though? I mean, even after that, listen, even after Serena broke back and got it on serve, Heather got a break again
and
served for it. So, you know, in some ways, she really engaged and stayed present in the moment.
Yeah, but she put it, the moment was too big.
I mean, and she hit, listen,
that's
what?
Fine.
She hit an ace to save the first break point. So, I mean...
Mm-hmm. She played a fantastic match.
She really did.
And if she can stay on the road that she's on, you know, good for you, girl, because you got big things coming. Because that, I mean, it was amazing.
Oh, you know what, though? I believe that's an Elizabeth Shue moment. And I like to call Elizabeth Shue moment is when someone has one Oscar-worthy performance in them, and then you will never see that again.
Oh, shit.
I am gonna say hallelujah to that, because that's
All right.
It's the truth.
Okay.
I mean, Heather, you can prove me wrong. I'm open to be proven wrong,
but I don't believe it.
I don't believe it. I'm with Andrina on this one. I mean, and I'm just gonna say, put out a couple names: Melanie O'Dam.
Hey.
No, she's not quite that, but you know what I mean. I actually do judge you harshly. Like, I think if you have the crowd lifting you up like that,
you better fly, girl.
And you have Serena packing her bags mentally. Then I'm sorry.
You know what? At the end of the day, Watson should have won that match. But this is exactly why you never count out a champion.
But Petra is a champion. So
fuck Petra. Petra ain't on. she ain't nowhere near Serena level. Nowhere near. Petra's crazy.
I mean, look. I mean, I pointed this out in the French Open where I said, you know, I mean, Petra makes 50-something errors, 40-something errors, and lose the match. Serena makes 50-something errors and win the match. And therein lies the difference between your number one and your number two. Petra doesn't have a middle game. It's either we're going all out. There is no B game. I mean,
you know what kind of made me think that Serena was not going to lose that match, even when she was down a double break?
Because her name is Serena Williams?
For one, she started getting down low to receive serve.
Exactly.
The second sign is she's no longer grunting. The angst is gone.
That's usually a big thing. When Serena gets quiet, it's usually when she is...
Like, buckle down,
bitches. Her best tennis. And, all of that technique. Angst was gone. Everything was gone. And she broke Watson from three... Watson was 3 game points to go...
Right.
For
love. She got broken not because she made errors, but because Serena just became Serena.
Yeah.
And you have to give the girl credit for that.
I give her credit, but you know how I feel.
No. There is no doubt. There's no doubt about that.
You got to snatch quick. You got to be like a thief in the night. Quickly. Like a Dustin Brown, although Rafa is no Serena, but I'm just saying. You got to run. You got to steal it, pickpocket, and
it was a
quick.
Beautiful thing to watch. It really was.
I think they get caught
Good
up
job,
in
though.
I think this is where I think Dustin Brown had that moment.
We're
not talking about him yet.
Let's skip Dustin.
But you know
what? My point is that I feel that Heather Watson forgot who she was playing across the net, and Serena remembered. I'm playing Heather Watson.
That's a good theory. I'm
not going home to Heather Watson, okay?
Right.
Maybe I'll leave the morning, but Heather Watson, girl.
Yeah.
You're not even top 32. Not on my watch. Okay.
In terms of, because, you know, we can always put down Serena's comebacks as down to her mentality and the refuse to lose attitude.
And she gets better. She plays better tennis.
In terms of the match, one of the biggest, I don't know if it's a disappointment, but I thought she really had a chance to make the second week again after being out in the wilderness for so long, was Sloane Stephens. I thought she played an incredible first set.
I had to read her name, and that broke my heart. She's my number three pick.
She went away.
I haven't seen the match on replay anywhere, and I'm hoping that, you know, somebody out in Twitterverse, Twitterland, has it, because I would really love to go back to see why she faded so much in the third set.
Faded with her serve. That's the thing. Yeah. Right? So that tells me that usually, right? I mean, usually when you sort of, she came out playing with fire in the first set and did exactly what you expected her to do against somebody like Lucy, who was still, I mean, up and down. But yeah, it was like you're watching the third set and someone said she was absent from the end of the first set. Like, I missed a little bit of the second. She was a little bit lethargic. She was a little bit sluggish.
That's great points in the beginning of the second set. But she didn't convert. And that's me where she went
like
down.
Like Petra. Maybe that's what... But you know what? Who has break points in the beginning of the in the second set after you've won the first set and goes away? You're still in the lead.
Exactly.
Right.
I just could not put a life. And it happened also in her match in Eastbourne against Aga. She had an incredible opportunity to get through to her first tour final. And if she had gone against Benchik, I don't know that she would have won, because I think Benchik has more game than her. But she would have been.
She would have been competing against Coco. And you know how the American. I mean, the American girls know each other's games fairly well. So I think
about Eastbourne.
I was talking about the next.
She competed in Eastbourne, but after a while, it's like her legs just disappeared from under her.
Hmm. I wonder what that was. But yeah, that's sort of Sloane reverting back to what we've been seeing, because she's been so engaged the last couple weeks in Europe that it was exciting. It was exciting to see her organize herself mentally on the court, not beat herself up too much. But the weird thing was then she retreated. She went back to her defensive style, which is fine on clay and fine at RG. But when she was running around and hustling for balls on that grass, I was like, girl, you're already losing the point. You're already losing the point. Because here comes Lucy's lefty running you off the court. And then she was trying for impossible shots. She was trying for around the pole shots. She was trying to go over the highest part of the net shot.
She's trying to aim points without actually being in position because that me, somebody who has been following Sloan for years, that has always been my problem with Sloan is that, one, like Andrine said, she tries to use her speed around the court to win matches without, you know, getting into position quickly enough, you know, with that first step. Her anticipation is just not there. Yeah. You know, you look at somebody like a Radwanska who seems to be where the ball is going to be rather than going, you know, she's always on the ball. And that's something, and that's a problem that Bouchard had as well when she was working with Saviano.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't remember she
was
existed.
Not there.
I just like didn't even know it until you said Bouchard. I was like, oh, yes, last year finalist. She's not here anymore. You know,
for me, a good tennis player is somebody who really anticipates shots, who is there in time, who reads the game well. You know, and that's, you know, when I saw Venus, people talk about that double bagel that Venus handed out, you know, first round. She was everywhere on that court. She knew where every ball was going to be, you know, and Madison Brengel, you know, good tennis player, but she was so predictable.
Yeah.
So predictable. She had
Venus was sending a message out to the Fed Cup girls. Your ass on show for fucking Fed Cup. This is what happened. Trying to play your ass. This is from me and this is from Mary Jo. One bagel from me and one bagel from Mary Jo.
Oh, can we talk Fed Cup? Can we talk about Anna?
Anna Ivanovic.
Aside from Anna Ivanovic, why did Bethany Mattox Sands implode against Bencic?
You know, because that's what she does. I mean, she can't be consistent over long periods of time.
I mean,
this was a fucking when she beat Anna. That was her opportunity to like do something.
Well, she went and she beat Anna. I guess that was her opportunity.
Well, she should have done more.
Oh, my Lord.
You're going to show up to Wimbledon looking like you look with your fucked up hair and your stupid clothes, you know, and you want everybody to say, hey, look at me. It's finally time for somebody to look at you for your tennis, and this is what you do?
Hey, she's won 2 Grand Slams this year.
Whatever. I'm happy for her doubles title.
We love doubles, eh?
But if you're going to continue to do this in the singles, you know, be consistent. I hate it. I'm all for an upset. I love it. I love to see things shaken up, but I can't stand when they fizzle out the next round. At least win one more match.
But
one
you
more.
Know what? She didn't need, and for me, she didn't. It wasn't like she was going to fizzle because she was in the lead in both sets. And then, and also, I guess Wozniacki's back is fine, I'm assuming. That's all.
Apparently, it is.
She went to Spain and got some treatment. Okay?
Somebody on Twitter, who was it? I need to look. Somebody on Twitter had said something about Wozniacki and about why she hasn't been through, you know, give me 2 seconds. It was Master Ace, I'm sure, because, you know, Master Ace likes to be all up in my shit. Asking me questions I can't answer.
Oh, while you're looking it up, I just got to say something. I am loving the new and improved Lucy Safarova.
Safarova. Gosh, get it right.
Can we just call her
Mrs. Thomas Burditch? I'm sure I'm saying Burditch right. Former Mrs. Thomas Burditch, okay?
No,
anyway.
Call her Lucy. And this one is Lucy Silent H.
Yes, just call her Lucy.
But
yes.
I think we're saying Lucy wrong as well, but whatever.
It doesn't matter. The sixth seed.
Anyway,
it's Lucy.
I just got to say, Lucy is being present for matches. Lucy is looking at these girls like, I'm not losing to you today. It's not happening.
Lucy has points to defend.
And yes, she has exactly.
No, Lucy likes that sixth floor apartment that she knows. Oh,
thank you very much.
Oh, my God.
Listen, whatever your motivations are, it's the same thing as JJ. Remember JJ? JJ's like, listen, I have a house I'm building. So
whatever you need to get in the next round. Because you know what we say here, Real Tennis Fan? Next round money is always better than this round money.
And you know what? And it's true. Because when I think, when I want to lay in my bed, I think about the trip I want to take to the World Tour Finals, and I hustle right out of bed. So whatever you need to do to get yourself through a match.
Exactly.
So listen, Master Ace says, since making the 2012 Australian Open quarterfinal, Wozniacki has only made it past the fourth round once, and that was the 2015 U.S. Open.
Last year, you mean?
Last year. So, you know, he's like, what are the reasons? I'll tell you what the reasons are.
Okay. Oh, Lord. She's going to get on Daddy?
Hold on. We got to be prepared for this. Because this is about to be a shocker.
Caroline Wozniacki, a.k.a. Golden Retriever.
Mm-hmm.
When she was number one, she played so many matches, and she won a lot. And she won a lot of smaller titles.
Mm-hmm.
But that's where she ranked her points up. She played like a slave to the game. She played and she played and she played and she ranked up them titles. But every time she came up one of the so-called big girls, she lost because she can't fucking hang. She doesn't have the game. She doesn't have it. And let us remember that back then when she was doing really well, Serena was absent.
I'm about to throw cold water on that.
No, I'm not done.
Uh-oh. I want to see this.
She just can't hang. She cannot hang with the big hitters. She can't do it. And I have had people come at me over the years recently and talk to me about how, you know, she's not the pusher that she used to be, and she hits a harder ball now and blah, blah, blah. And you know what? That's all fine and wonderful. She still can't hang. She might play the big girls tighter and closer. Her matches against Serena lately have been tighter and closer, but she's not winning. And she's not playing as much as she used to. She slowly crept back up. What is she ranked now? I don't even know.
She's close to being number three.
She's back up there.
Thank
she's winning
Petra.
More.
Thank
but,
you.
Yeah, she just, I mean, she can't hang with Serena. She can't hang with, she gets overpowered by the big hitters. She can't do it.
Okay. Karen, no, your cold water?
I don't lie to the fact that Wozniacki won a lot of smaller tournaments. So, you know,
when I say smaller tournaments, I mean, I am not a fan of the slamless number one, and that's what I'm talking about. Okay. I don't care if it was a Masters 500, 1,000, 250 challenger.
I always look at a player's credentials based on their overall work.
Well, I don't. If you're number one in the world, I want you winning slams. I want it.
Overall body of work. And on the WTA, on the regular tour, yes, she won a lot of titles, but they were not small titles. They were big titles. She won Montreal, Toronto, Beijing, Tokyo. These are premier mandatory events. And she won them, and she competed. And
she did, and she did well.
And during the absence of the so-called stars of the game, she carried that tour.
She held it down.
She did.
And 2011, she carried that tour. She was the face of the WTA in the absence of Serena and Venus and Petra and who else? And Sharapova and Ivanovic and everybody else who had basically done a disappearing act. It was the Wozniacki tour with a bunch of Russians. And she owned them. So
you know what? I don't disagree with you at all. I do not disagree with you.
I really give her credit for that. I think Wozniacki's downfall is not as she was being hit off the court during that time. It's the fact that she needs to let go of her dad and the coach.
Wait,
she could win love, 6'1", and here comes dad running down on court. What the fuck are you going to tell your daughter? What are you going to tell her? She just bageled somebody. She just breadsticked somebody, hitting one winner and no errors. And you're coming down to say what? Hey, good job. Do that again. You know?
I get it. I just, like I said, I am not a fan of the slamless number one. I'm not. And I mean, it's a debate maybe for another day, but you know, I don't like it. That is my personal opinion. And I think it speaks volumes when you can't show up at the so-called right time, in my mind. It's my world.
Okay. So I want to say something, but I'm afraid Tennis Jesus, you know, hold me back. I'm afraid.
Say it.
But you know what? I'm going to say it silently and softly. I am so impressed by Venus Williams. I'm just so impressed.
It's a reason for that.
Right. I'm just going to put it out there, folks. We didn't forget her, but it's just all
no,
I want to say.
No, we haven't forgotten her.
I just all I want to say, Venus.
And I'm going to make
I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow.
Yes.
You know, but...
We love you, Venus. And we are here for you. And I know Serena stans are going to kill me, but I was really slightly praying for Heather because I wanted Venus to take it. I know. There's a lot. But you know what? Listen, we all know that... When Venus
Lock
is
party.
No, I don't
Locking
care.
You.
Let me just, listen. I'm coming out, but let me just tell you, we know how rare it is to get Venus just in a zone, right? And so Serena's always in a zone, but when we get Venus in a zone, which is rare at times, we need these zones to continue.
Exactly.
I need to clear the path, and I get it. You know, because everybody takes these things. Everybody takes this for granted. But you can't take it for granted. We have been Venus fans for a long time, and you cannot take a good Venus run for granted. You
know what? Back in the 90s, folks.
We all know in the U.S. Open, Serena's going to be in the conversation. But we have no idea what is in line for Venus. We don't.
Who are you picking for the winner?
I think Venus has a shot, and I think Venus has the crowd on her side. Not that that will help, but I think the crowd plus Venus having a shot, I don't know. And plus Serena going for her big moment. I do think all of those things coalesce to possibly give us – and Venus is playing well. I mean, she is playing more than well.
You know the worst part about this, Andre?
What?
Serena mindset when she almost loses.
I know.
She buckles down.
Sloan Stephens, when I want to tell you to release the beat, this is what it is. Sharapova and Serena have that, releasing that.
But we all have to stop, though, because I do think the moment is increasingly getting bigger and bigger for Serena. And I think that if it's going to get big across from her sister, there will be many things going on. I know that we all want to believe that she can shut off now, but I don't really think so. I think this is a big moment. So I'm going by history. But it's going to end early, so we'll all know.
I just tweeted out, you know, quick poll, who's going to win tomorrow, and the majority of the people that have answered they're going with Venus. And you know what, I gotta tell you, I'm leaning with Venus, and I don't know why. I'm not even sure where that's coming from. It's just a feeling that I have. And like Andreen said, there's so much more going on with this tournament than just Wimbledon for Serena. So much more.
We'll see, and we know that
And that's problematic. Her serve is on point, And she's moving extremely well.
And they're sisters. And who's, you know, Venus knows whether she wants to talk about it or not. This is an opportunity that doesn't come along very often anymore. And she's going to pounce. I think she is going to fucking pounce. And she, Serena's going to see a Venus that she hasn't seen in a long time because, well, they don't play to each other that much anymore. You know,
she
I mean,
at Venus in 2008 final.
It's 2015. I mean,
I know, but that Venus in 2008 is the same Venus I'm seeing right now. That Venus in 2008 was like Gandalf. You will not pass, Balrog. You will not pass.
I'm excited for it.
I am too.
Serena was so mad. I have never seen Serena mad at Venus, but she was mad 2008.
Whoa, get mad. Get mad, girl. Get mad.
Get mad.
Tomorrow, I want you to call Venus a bitch. I want you to call her a bitch as you go shake her hand and say,
but you know what? Honestly, I mean,
I don't care.
My hope for Venus. The unfortunate thing is just like Venus is so unpredictable in terms of, like, you know, health, body wise. So even if she does win tomorrow, I'm gonna be so fucking mad. You can't even talk to her if she doesn't win the tournament.
Okay,
we're not even gonna have a podcast next Sunday.
Wait, let's just let her get through the fourth round. Let's just let her get through.
The fourth round. You know what I should do? I should run with the draw when it gets to the round of 16.
What should they do?
Reshuffle.
You're
only gonna say this shit once. The only one is
once. I'm gonna say this.
And the top half looks like a Grand Slam semifinal or final.
Yeah.
Any of those matches on the top half could be a Grand Slam semifinal.
Well, yeah. I don't even know those people.
The names don't sound familiar, Janina.
I can't say them. Let me try. Wait, let me try. We got Yankovic.
It's crazy.
Oh my god, I love it. I'm gonna put that out on blast for you.
Madison Keys, come through. Madison Keys, this is your shot for another major final.
I just want to say that I had her coming this far. I did.
Keith, this is your year to beat the Bouchard, to beat the Halep, and the Sloan, who just showing up at majors and flunk everywhere else. This is your turn.
It's really fun because let's look at the round of 16. Then let's look at these matches. We just went through Serena Venus, but look at the exciting ones coming up. What else are we looking forward to?
I'm looking forward mostly, I think, after Serena and Venus, to JJ and Radwanska.
That's going to be tasty. That's a tasty match.
I'm telling you, because I know JJ's not going to fail me. But you know what? JJ has played so much tennis this three.
You know what?
JJ almost lost to Beth Nina.
Garbine Muguruza.
That should be fun.
That is a match I have to watch tomorrow.
I know it's going to be a million errors on Garbine's side. Because
apart from that falter in the second set against Kerber, when Kerber was just playing zoning tennis.
Garbine took a break.
Garbine played mentally tough tennis. It was like how she played against Serena at the French Open that year when she won. She was just on. She was just mental, especially in the first set. She just stayed focused. Every single time she was down set point, she either came up with a big serve or that backhand down the line was just kissing the line every single time.
Yes.
So I'm looking for her to do the same thing against Wozniacki tomorrow.
I think so. And you know what? Can I tell you which match I thoroughly enjoyed? Tamia versus Lisicki.
Oh, God. Yeah.
Oh, that was beautiful.
First of all, you ladies need to tell me that I was right. You called me out and be like, oh, no. Tamia,
we ain't telling you shit.
We're not even gonna care.
No, we're just gonna say we are happy that Tamia made it through because Tamia played a tennis match and Lisicki played what usual. I can't serve myself out of a paper bag match.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm telling that you. Even if you double bagged it, Sabine Campbell serve.
You hit the most aces, you have the fastest serve, and you can't fucking put a serving court. Yeah.
Or keep the ball.
Keep the ball.
The lines. I mean, it was so wonderful to see Tamia play that well, though. She was so steady. And that backhand, Lord, she trusts that backhand. But I'm trusting that backhand against Niculescu. But can we all admit, look at this. This is somebody we didn't think was going to. I thought Sveta was going to sneak through this, but I should have known.
You know
better.
What? I mean, so, you know, she needs to go ahead and let me just be her love child.
I watch a lot of tennis, and I watch Kristina Pliskova. Sveta, I have no words.
I don't want to talk.
She had a Petra moment where all of a sudden we're just not about hitting balls and court, and we're just not playing. Oh, I mean, Virginia right. Wade was losing her mind.
I know.
Virginia was just like. What's going on? Oh no! I mean, like, it was disapproved. I mean, Virginia was just like,
I have Virginia to say, I like it. Right?
What is she doing?
Oh no! You just can't hit that shot. Like,
she lives and dies. Virginia Wade lives and dies by the points, and it is hilarious when you are going wrong. When you are going down a wrong road, she cannot take it. She's so frustrated.
She felt so exasperated. She's like, what is she doing?
Why are you trying to hit that shot from that position? I mean, that's like, you know. Oh, that volley was just not
enough. I want all commies to live and die by points like that. If I could, I would have 10 Virginia Raids over John McEnroe.
Oh, my God.
I love Virginia. I love her. I just love her. Most of the time. And if she says anything crazy, you know.
Yeah, she can be crazy, but at least she's present and engaged with each point.
And she's not hating on the women and, you know, slaying them and saying some crazy shit. All the time.
She shades, though. She does give a good shade.
Upset
specials.
Yeah, let's wrap up these ladies. What are your final thoughts on the ladies? Who's coming through? Go quick.
I say Muguruza versus Baczynski, and Madison Keys, I hope. Because you never know with Madison, she could lock herself out of a match, and versus Yelena. And I think Madison beat Yelena because Yelena is just run out of gas. And I think Baczynski will get Muguruza, so it would be Baczynski semifinals. Venus, forgive me, Serena. It's not going to fuck around with you. She don't care if you're wobbling in a wheelchair over there. She's just not interested in that.
Okay, go ahead.
She's not interested in that life. So, Serena, I think you're going to get it. If Venus gets through, I say Venus goes all the way and she grabs Maria Wade again. Actually, but I think Lucy might actually beat Maria in the quarterfinal.
I think so, too. Mm-hmm.
So it's going to be a tough match. Venus, don't try to fuck around and say you can't serve against Lucy because I will be mad as shit.
Why y'all counting out Coco?
I know. Stop it.
I wasn't even counting Coco in, but you know what?
Go for it. Right.
That's it, really. Yeah, that's my point. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Karen?
Oh, man. I'm torn. I have a Williams going through.
Oh, bunch of... Benchit over Azarenka.
Wait, I
have Muguruza over Wozniacki, JJ over, no, Aga over JJ, actually. Mm-hmm. Safarova taking out, I don't even know who, I can't even read my
Coco. Coco.
And Benchit, I have taken out Vika.
Yep.
I think so too.
Yeah. And Keys over Govortsova, Keys and Niculescu. Oh, I don't know. I have a Williams. I have a Williams Keys final.
Yes, a Williams Keys final.
A Williams Keys final. That's interesting.
Ooh, an All American final would be fine.
I like it. I like it. Like it.
Yeah.
Williams. Yeah. Now you know. And ever so often, you know, I like the color factor. You know, I do like the color combo.
I like all of that. I don't think I'm any different than anyone in this moment. I think my only difference is, I'm going to say, I think we're all on board. I think that Lucy will take out Sharapova. I think there's a reason why Lucy's been struggling. She's looking ahead to Sharapova, seeing that she's going to play some struggle tennis. both of them. I do think Bencic takes out Vika, although they're both quote-unquote injured, so we'll see how that works. And there will be a Williams in the final. I really honestly don't know. I'll be a wimp and say I don't know which Williams, but there will be a Williams in the final, and I do.
But I'll be happy either way. Venus, if it's you, no one can talk to me on Sunday. If it's not you, you know, you can say hello to me.
I think actually you, a possibility of a rematch between Tamia and a Williams.
All right.
Well, maybe. I think Tamia might be able to sneak out of that section.
I don't have any picks.
Janine, you don't have any picks. Okay.
All right. She don't want to pick.
But you know what? It's time for ladies.
We know where your heart's at, girl.
Yes.
Exactly. You know who's at the door, ladies?
Oh, who's at the door?
It's Steve Adal, Rafa, because he left the house. He's coming over to visit us.
Hi,
he
Rafa.
Left Wimbledon early.
Oh.
Yes, I'm here.
My. And guess who took him out?
Is Rafa coming through the door to bid me a little magic mic number? Because I'm okay with that. Would you like me to play a song for you?
No, yes. He's not. You can take sneak in his underwear, but you can't.
Take that shirt off and let's go. Bang, chicka, bang, bang. Thank you very much for stopping by and delivering this wonderful thing now.
David Al is here to tell us that it's time to talk about the men's tournament.
Oh,
the
ladies. Is it happy hour somewhere in the world now?
Yes, it is. Go ahead.
I need to go get myself a glass of wine.
You can think of it as communion, Karen, because we're at church on Middle Sunday, Wimbledon. Think of it as communion.
Praise the Lord.
Praise Dennis Divas.
Yeah.
Is that the biggest upset on the men's side? Is it?
No.
No. And you know what? Praise God for Rafa, because if not for Rafa, we would be in Boring City, because nobody has done anything remotely dramatic in terms of the upset road. No one. Everyone's made it through that you expect would make it through, right?
I want to start off with Andrine publicly saying that we were.
No, hold up.
Wait.
You're telling us right now in here, in your magic psychic eye, of all things men tennis, where you have never been wrong. You saw Dennis Kudla making it to the round. The 16?
Well, you know what? It was
right
a week.
Now. If you lot of numbers.
You know what? I won't, because you know what? But we all said that part of the draw was going to be soft. Once Kai went out, once Kay went out, and once Rafa went out, that section was like, ba-da! Swim through this, honey. Anybody wants to go upstream?
You're right. I beg your pardon.
You know, I mean, yeah. So once once Kay retired, that was a soft section. So. Anybody wanted to pass through. I would have expected somebody who's gotten a little bit more buzz to pass through, like me, like Zverev. But
like
that
who?
Didn't happen. The German.
Alexander. Yeah, you know.
But you
yes,
know,
we did say at the beginning that this was an opportunity for scrubs and bus boys to come through to make some money.
Only so far until they meet Novak, and you know, Andrine thought somebody. I don't know.
Oh yes, this was okay. This is the moment you could flame me, because I thought that the men were going to show up like a Heather Watson and say, "Girl, I'm trying to snatch your wig."
Yeah, not happening.
None of the men decided to take it to Nole, because as always, the men respond to hierarchy, as I always say. The top dog always bows down. They all bow down to the top dog. Not even Tomic. Tomic could have had a Heather Watson moment.
Well, he obviously has other things on his mind, which we can discuss in a little bit.
That he does.
But
that he does. He wasn't the most alive.
I am surprised to see Dr. Ivo where he is, and I'm happy for him. You know what, old man? Good for you.
Well, because it was an opportunity for Dolgo. No, he didn't cheat. I mean, you know what?
It's not his fault.
I'm just being controversial.
I know, but that was the point of the chair umpire, because it happened right under his eye.
And it was clear. It was clear to see. It was.
It's clear on a slow-mo. Not so much in real time.
Actually, you know what? That is exactly what Evo Kolovic said.
It's true. On the slow-mo, it looks like a double hit, but, you know, in real eyes.
It is a double hit. It looks like a... No, no. Because you can literally see him move his... I mean, Roger would have explained it to you.
The ball cannot hit the ground like that unless it was hit twice.
Exactly, the trajectory. No, that backspin and that shit. No, he hit it twice. But no.
Butter is such a tennis nerd. I love it. But I am surprised to see him where he is, because there are plenty of people along the way that could have and probably should have gotten rid of him. And he's played hard. And you know what? Good for you.
But you know what? It was inevitable that Joe would do that, right? Because Joe can't return to...
He doesn't return a ball. He doesn't look nearly as bulky as he did at the French Open. I'm just saying.
He went on a diet. So we have Karlovic versus Andy Murray. I mean, I have to say, you know, the round of 16 for the men is a little bit, you know...
Playing second fiddle to the women as usual.
Oh,
you know, I mean, you know me.
I hate them all. I'm telling you.
Ratings don't lie, people.
I'm straight. You know me. I'm straight up all about the men's tour quite a number of times, but I will have to admit and concede to Karen that the ladies have delivered this tournament.
They have.
With the upsets, the fabulous matches. I think so far they've played the matches of the tournament. So
Maruza versus Angelique Kerber first set.
I mean,
first high set point was out of control. I mean, those girls were going for that ball. Just putting it out there, people, go and watch it. Just saying.
If tradition holds, which sometimes it does, usually the beginning of the women's tournament is better than the end, and then the men's end sometimes is better than the beginning, which is why in people's memory the men's tournament always turns out to be exciting in their mind, because it's recentism.
Exactly. It's the last thing the judges ever see.
Stick the landing. And everybody's like, oh my god, that was great. And then you go, wait, what were the great matches? Oh no, there wasn't any. That's exactly right, because let's look at this. We've got Pospisil versus Victor Troitsky.
Pospisil come through. First of all, let me just say, I am the king of the scrubs, okay? I am the king of the scrubs. My scrubs have been delivering money, and you folks have been saying that I chose some foolish players. Look at it. Smicek, we're not even going to count it, but he got that first round money, and that's good enough for him, because he usually never gets out of quality again. But
Tony, are you listening? How do you feel about Smicek, you lying bastards?
But you know what?
Pospisil is in the fourth round.
No, but let's look at this Murray section. Who wants to get a quarterfinal versus Victor Troitsky or Pospisil if you're Murray?
Me!
I think if he gets past Karlovic, that is, because that could be an obscenely annoying set of five sets.
Yes, isn't it? Tiebreaker.
and you know, Andy Murray's second serve. This could be the time for some DFs. So we'll see how that works. And then we've got the delightful Burdich versus Simone. That's a treat.
You don't like it? You don't like some Czech French pastry?
I don't know. I don't like it. And then, you know, Burdich versus Federer or RBA, because, you know, RBA likes an upset, but he doesn't see Del Potro across the court, so we should be okay with that. And how much of a buzzkill was it to see Isner go out? How many games? 10 minutes? 10 minutes, oh, he returned to the court.
You know what annoyed me even more than anything? That Isner losing in 10 minutes?
A double fault?
No, that wasn't even it. It was the fact that Justin Gimelstab was standing up.
Oh my God, that was like the worst part of Wimbledon. I'm telling
you, that you all in your Justin shoes.
I was hot. I was hot. I was hotter. I'm telling you. I touched my con. I'm telling you, I was gonna cut off your head because I was so mad. Because I was like, you know what, Justin Gimelstab, you didn't even give this motherfucker a game plan, and you're they're clapping like some shit cute is happening out there.
But how? Oh, hey, clapping. How ironic that it ends in a double fault.
I mean, it was.
It's painful.
It's John Isner. Remember, it's John Isner.
No, but you know, I mean, he was struggling on his service game for a good while. And if Cilic had been able to capitalize on some of those break points, he wouldn't have had to get up and come out and play a second day. But so yes, we've got Cilic. Delightful. Cilic Kudler. So that'll be like a real nail biter right there.
Set your clocks, folks. You gotta wake up early for this match. You
if I start customizing voice entry, oh my God.
I mean, let's be honest. Look at these matchups. Stan versus Goffin. I mean, is Stan gonna just
do it? That sounds like that could be a nail biter.
That could be good unless Stan is feeling imperious and sees Federer across the net in some weird shape or fashion and decides that he wants to go to town. But I actually think the match I'm looking forward to of all
is
that
Gasquet
versus Nick. Yes, because you know
that should be good.
That should be good.
That should be good.
That should be fun. I mean, it's doable by both of them, so that means that should be a right tussle, and that has the potential to be the men's match that should be, you know, a riot. So
is this
your clusterfuck?
Yes, that could be my clusterfuck moment.
You know what? It could be so
good.
Full of mental meltdowns. Oh, my God.
Although Gasquet handled Nick very nicely when they met in, I think, was it a clay court match? I think it was like a 250 or something like that. Where was that? Istanbul? No, it wasn't Istanbul. Somewhere.
Last year, he lost 12 match points.
No, Portugal. Yeah, Portugal. That's the recent time they played. Gasquet handled him well. But I think on the grass, it should be a real treat.
Mm-hmm. And Gasquet, I got to say thank you for coming through for handling Dimitrov.
Oh.
Thank you. That was another French takedown.
You know what I have to do?
Another French takedown. I'm telling you.
Get a coach. Get a coach, Grigor. Get a motherfucking coach. Get a new coach.
Definitely.
It is time to change something.
Grigor does not. So let me ask you a question. Who will pick a new coach up first, Grigor or Rafa Nadal?
Grigor.
Grigor.
Rafa is going to live and die by Uncle Tony.
You see, and I'm not really a diva. You know, folks tell me I am disrespectful of Diva now. But I just got to say, I don't think he needs to change coach. I think he needs to get some addition, someone else.
Not need to change coaches, but it's time for a fresh set of eyes. And that's good for anybody.
Right.
Even if they don't stick around. You're always somebody from the outside.
Miyake.
Can always
for a week.
Yeah,
are we willing to say that Rafa is as dependent on Uncle Tony?
Oh hell yeah!
As Carolyn Wozniacki is on her daddy.
Yeah.
Oh God, yes. Yeah.
Oh yeah. I'm just gonna drop that there and say who's your daddy? And so no, Tio Tony. I don't think that's gonna happen.
I don't think so.
That's a kind of graduation.
Not with anybody else. He's not about that life. He's not. He's not about having someone else talk over him. No, not happening. Not happening. Mm-mm.
Can we talk about a little bit aside though? Can we talk about how that camp showed no support for Rafa during that match? Zero. They were as pressed as you could possibly be.
Like a doorbell.
I mean, no clapping, no firing up. It was like a funeral. It was
a funeral in that section.
If you looked up there
well,
and you
then,
wanted
you
support,
know, maybe it was planned.
They expected him to win.
They didn't expect him to win. But it didn't look like they expected him to win, but it looked like they were frustrated by him. You know what I mean? It was like
Uncle Tony had that look on his face like this motherfucker out here losing not to a scrub, but to a buff boy. Justin Drum can't even get out of challenges. And up here, challenging motherfucking Rafa Nadal. 14 times.
Well, but you know what? For the first time, surface was wonderful. You know, it's like Dustin said even afterwards, because even though everybody's going to critique Dustin for not continuing the run, Dustin said, I felt comfortable beating him previously, and so I knew my game was a good match for his, so yep. I knew that I could comfortably play my game, and even though in a weird way it seemed like, at least in terms of the fans and in terms of the commentators, they kept remarking on how brave it was for Dustin to continue to play as he was playing, but Dustin felt like he was entirely in his comfort zone.
Well, and he like, even said, like, I don't like, want to play him on clay or hardcore.
But on this surface, everything I know about grass could come through.
Yeah, and it did.
From the very beginning, the problem, it's like, it's always that moment when I watch Rafa Nadal matches. There is a moment where, a seminal moment for me where I just knew things are going to go shit.
When the ball what you mean when the ball lands in the bottom of the net or something like that?
No, not even that. There was a point when I think what's his name broke first. I think Dustin broke first.
Yeah, he did.
No. He broke first. He broke Dustin first. And usually, Divadal don't need because Dustin started off.
And then it went back and forth.
Dustin started off like he's always been here. Like he's always at center court. Like he's not always playing doubles on the 8-court 8. Dustin was looked like he belonged, and that was the first thing that was shocked me. Like, you know, Dustin wasn't overcome by the moment. And then Dustin played a very good first game, and he was like on his shit, stopping up on his toes, confident. Like, you know, it's like, oh my, I was just like, girl, you're really into this match. Then I just said, wait, Divadal's going to break you. And sure enough, Divadal broke him. And I was just like, all right, then, 6-1, 6-2, 6-3, ABC. One of those arithmetic matches. But then Dustin broke back. And Divadal didn't know what to do at that point. And that's when I just like, oh, this might be, Dustin might really get a 2-love lead over Divadal.
And it was one of those matches where, you know, the narrative about Nadal, which is that Nadal is always changing his game. This match was the counter, the counter to that narrative, which is that Nadal didn't do anything different.
Exactly.
And you know, he wanted that 2010 serve, but it wasn't there.
Nothing came through. That forehand was in that service box.
Yeah.
He wasn't pushing Dustin around. He didn't even try to even get the crowd involved. Like, you know what? I am Nadal.
No, because the crowd was all about Dustin, because we all know that when you see chocolate in full flow, there's nothing you can do, honey. There's nothing you can do. Listen, I'm about to call you out right now and let you all know that that's what it is. When we see real dark chocolate in flow.
With the dreadlocks.
With the dreadlocks. All those people in the audience were like, oh, dear Lord.
I'm just, gonna, just I'm getting just mesmerized by the loveliness of it all.
Everybody forgot that they thought Rafa Nadal was hot in that match. Let's all just call it what it is. And
I just wish Dustin Brown would like get bigger.
Well, honey, we all wish something things would get bigger, but it ain't gonna happen.
Dustin is big, it's big count, okay, Janina?
Okay.
Dustin is big.
He's just really skinny.
I know, honey.
Those are the ones you need to be afraid of.
Oh my God. So anyway,
sorry.
Are we at all surprised about the consistency of Mr. Wawrinka?
Ugh. Yes. I told you. Well, I was a little bit surprised by how quickly Verdasco fell down to his knees. Right. That was quick.
And bow down.
Well, he had no time, right? He was already done with all the
sets. He was tired.
He had played all of his sets accounted for.
He was taking the Monfils.
He took a Monfils route.
Did the Monfils method of winning majors, you know?
Yeah,
I don't know why, because it has not worked. Monfils has not been to a major finals, people. Do not be playing fucking 5-set matches in the first 2-3 rounds. You're not going to get anywhere.
Although I want... Oh, you know what? Either of those will work. Stan versus Gasquet is a trippy match. They've played some close ones in the past. Or Stan versus Nick. I'm here for the takedown of Stan in the quarters.
You think Nick is going to do it? I think Nick totally can do it. I don't know if he will do it.
I say Stanley has the better game. Stanley has more variety in this game.
He does, but Nick has the serve. And Stan's second serve is not
Nick is playing really well. I mean, I think it would be a fun match. I think it'll be a fun match. And Nick just brings this fucking swagger that might throw
isn't it just what Nick wants to take out the RG champ? Come on.
Yes, it's
true. He's going to be a Lizicki.
Yes, right? He wants that. He wants to swagger up and say, this dude just want to slam and I'm going to take
him. Hey, you know what? So I say go for it, buddy.
You try.
I don't know. I mean, I'm gonna favor Stanley here because I thought the moment for Stanley fucking up had already come and gone.
No, there's no moment for him to fuck up. There was no moment. What?
Yeah, match one.
Exactly.
Not necessarily by who he was playing. We were hoping him. Yeah, just him. Was he going to be consistent after having just won a major? No. And you know what? He is. And I really, really, I want Stan to come through this section because I'm expecting Novak to come through. And I want to see them play on grass.
I'm not looking forward to a Swiss final, so I'm just letting you know that.
Well, that's fine.
Hold on. You just blasphemed a while ago. Andreen, just clarify that statement.
I don't want an all Swiss final.
Oh, okay,
why?
Okay,
because you don't think Federer will come out on top?
He should, but those matches are ugly.
you know Marco's gonna show her ass on Santa Cruz. We can't have that.
Oh, that'd be great.
Listen, we should all wear crybaby t-shirts. But anyway,
my God.
So what did you say,
Karen? I'm just here for the Federer bandwagon.
Hey, jump on.
Every single year.
I know. I was 18 every year.
I was a little bit nervous about Federer possibly meeting Burdich, but given that Burdich played the way he played against Pablo, I ain't worried no more.
You know, Burdich will find his 2010 game.
Always.
Federer's playing well.
No, I tell you, they all get up for the Fed.
They do.
So we do. And I love it.
Sometimes I truly wonder if a player thinks it's a bigger deal to beat Federer somewhere along the way than to win the whole fucking thing when they play against him.
Oh,
it's more important to have that on their resume than a damn title.
Seppi said as much. He said, you know, it's a bigger deal to beat Federer than to beat Murray.
Did he say that?
Yeah, he did.
Oh, Jesus. So, I don't know. You know what? I'll be honest with you.
I can tell my grandchildren that I beat so-and-so.
Right. Yeah, who cares about the title? The title might not even exist.
And they're saying that in some old broken-down house looking like quarters.
Stop it, though. But you know
what? They had an opportunity to be living in a mansion by winning some fucking title.
Well, you know, sometimes the title might not even exist then. You know, you don't know what the tour is going to look like, but the person will always be there.
You see, this is my problem. You know, I'm all about the money, right? I'm all about the cha-ching. Yeah. And, you know, scrubs, this is why you all would always be scrubs and bustable. You see, the ladies just beat the number one player and beat some big, and they translate that into endorsement. You see them in some chewing gum or some shoes or some shit.
I mean, you saw that stuff that got slapped on JJ's boob right before she came out.
I mean, look at Wozniacki. Yes, she got to number one. That is true. But Wozniacki was everywhere. She was in the Emirates playing everywhere. She translates some good, solid wins into money. But you fucking scrubs don't do shit. You don't have to win the title. Like I've been saying to you, Monfils, just show up in the final, motherfucker, and you will be rich beyond belief.
He don't care. He's already rich.
You're not about that. And you other scrubs need to step up and do some shit like that. But you know what?
Anyway, I'm anxious to get to news. So can we round out the men so we can talk a little bit about some of the news?
The men are boring right now. I'm just
waiting. Happen.
Oh. They are not always boring, Karen. Back off.
It's just that we have not.
I am going to call
we
it
have
right
not,
now.
We've not had our young'uns come on through like
that. Exactly. These,
we've been
these
waiting young for the, what did Andrew Burton call them? The ATP lost boys?
Lost
these
boys.
These young guns are shooting blanks. They're shooting blanks. That's all I'm going to say.
I'm blaming racket technology, but anyway.
You're just going to turn it out there, aren't you?
Okay, yeah. Let's see where we're going to be. So I'm going to take Victor Troitsky because I know Victor knows his moment. Victor, listen, Victor ain't losing to Pospisil. So Victor will come through to face Andy Murray, so they can have a retussle, I think, because they may just play each other queens. Burdich to do his dance on Federer if he can. Nole and Cilic, because that seems to be something we need to have as a tradition every year at Wimbledon. And Stan, I'm going to say Stan versus Nick, although I would be perfectly happy if it was Goffin versus Gasquet, but we're probably going to go with the experience and say Stan versus Nick.
I'm giving Goffin a chance.
I'm giving Goffin a chance too, because Goffin actually can actually hit the ball on grass, and Stan actually hasn't encountered anyone who can play comfortably on grass yet.
Oh yes, so, he looks so good against Baghdadis. I was so impressed by Goffin's game. Yes. It was so beautiful. It was so beautiful to watch him play on
Baghdadis. Actually, that should be pretty tennis. It should be pretty tennis. So
Let me see if can I watch that tomorrow. Better see what the match the lineup is.
ATP can always lie and say they have a young one coming up.
Oh well, so Goffin is right up in there. Right? So any real upset possibilities? I don't really see it. I mean, I don't think Cilic is deciding that this is going to be his U.S. Open moment to take out Nole like he took out Fed. So, it's probably going to be Nole. I mean, actually, you know what? I think Ivo has a real shot because we all made fun of the medical timeout, but Murray is having a shoulder issue. So that
Murray needed a hug. That was a hug. I don't care what anybody tells me this shit. He needed a hug. That man got him on the ground, put Murray on the ground, and held him like a baby. And just like, Murray, it is okay. Murray sent the code. You are the
guys.
Little hair. You will be okay. You will be fine. Came back out and won 6 straight games. Get the fuck out of here with some shoulder. Maria Sharapova wish she had that kind of shoulder injury.
I know, really. But, you know, so the reality is the men's section right now is kind of blah, and so we're pretty much waiting for the semis in the final, because who knows?
We don't really care.
We don't really care about any of the matches. I mean,
stuff already happened.
Yeah, there's like an ounce of excitement compared to, say, the women's.
I want to see Nick Kyrgios come through and act like a complete fucking fool.
Yes.
I am so over that.
I enjoy it.
I guess this is bringing some sex.
You know what? I love tennis. Tennis can be boring.
Wait, let's ask. So this is the question for this section. Mm-hmm. Is Nick an asshole?
Yeah, is Nick an asshole?
Yes. Or is he just
he's
young?
Not. He's more of a cunt. Cunt is a really good thing.
Let's see. Twitter poll. Is Nick an asshole or a cunt?
Oh, wow.
Going with it. Wow. I like
it. Go with it. And so Karen is coming in under cunt.
Mm-hmm.
I'm coming in under confused. Confused by the old people telling him that he needs to be more exciting and not realizing that there's a difference between being exciting and being a little bit of a douchebag. But I'm still in the Nick camp because I love it still. I still love a little bit of life in those legs.
You know what?
So I'm okay. He hasn't crossed any lines for me yet.
But
my lines are very, I guess my lines are very broad.
I took a moment, you know, like Karen usually does, Karen usually does, you know, she take a moment and reflect on something. I know I look at the whole big picture. And you know what I guess I'm going to say about the young generation? They're looking to be social media tennis legends and that actual tennis legend. Because Nick is on some social media campaign, him and his brother, whatever his girl, I don't even care what your name is. Y'all are shouting too loud. You know, Nick needs to win some titles. He just needs to. Nick just can't be winning because Amanda Kutz, I think, beat Steffi Graf.
Amanda Kutz, I love that name.
Nobody cares, okay? Nick just got to one final since all the talk we've been talking about Nick. He beat Rafa last year, didn't get to a finals. You know, he needs to produce quality. Okay, yes, I understand he is Tennis Australia life. Okay? But you know who he's competing against? Not Bernard Tomic. Leighton Hewitt, who is in a wheelchair.
That's stop.
I mean, it's true. I mean, so I really need, I mean, I like Nick. I like his game when he is focused on tennis. I mean, it's a beautiful thing to watch. He's big. He's moved well. He has the power. He has the finesse. He really thinks out there, during, you know, getting himself out of trouble. You know, but all this extra shit, it's too extra. It's well past.
I'm fine with it. Tennis can be boring. It can be boring, and it's fun to have somebody shake it up, and he can keep on shaking it up. Yes. And so far, we've got one vote for cunt.
Come out of the closet.
We've got a vote from Luke, who says he's a cunt. Sam's bicep says he agrees with Andrine. So, you know, I mean, shake it up, baby, shake it up.
He hasn't crossed the line for me yet.
And you know what?
I like, though, I will say, I do find the irony of people trashing Nick for things that they have appreciated and loved about their own personal faves for years. So,
Right.
I'm about to drop it. Federer is out of the equation. Federer doesn't do those things. I mean, why would you even throw Federer in there? He's not even a part of these kinds of things. When he was a kid, maybe. But no, I'm just saying that I think a lot of people are uncomfortable. Seeing a brown person.
True.
Do that. Because you should just be grateful to be there. And I'm just going to leave that right there.
Okay.
I agree half the time. But you know what? Just a little bit, I agree with you here. But you see what? Nick Kyrgios standing up on a piece of wire to watch a match.
I didn't see the same outrage when Alexander did the exact same thing in confronting the umpire as I saw all over Twitter when Nick did it. Why? Is it because he's blonde? Everybody needs to get
a
little
like a
bit.
Who looks like a boy?
Yeah, I mean, I think people are slightly uncomfortable.
Oh, that, I agree.
When brown folks don't comport themselves with a level of gratitude to be there. Now, I'm not saying that Nick hasn't done asshole things. Believe me, I will go there with you. But I think sometimes the critique...
It's too much.
There's a shade of something about these critiques. So I'm just going to... I think people need to do a little self-reflection. And come back to me, because when I see it, let's just say we've all know that certain people have done things on tour that if a person of color had done it, we'd all be lined up and taking.
You know what? Interesting enough, I just want to say something. During this arena, I guess we will talk about this later, but just during this arena, I had a Watson match when the umpire was showing themselves booing. Serena went up to the umpire, not about the booing. She said, you know, they were calling out during the points, which happened.
Yep.
And she asked the umpire, you know, I don't know his name. A friend of mine said, they were only booing. And how interesting of his three persons of color running the shit, right? But you know what?
Anyway.
I'm not even about that.
Anyway,
but,
we will pretend that those things don't exist.
Serena was arguing with the umpire, and that's why they were booing. I was just like, what the fuck are you talking about? Serena had no argument with any umpire. Serena doesn't argue with umpire anymore. She made her
case clearly. It was not an argument.
And then she walked away. Exactly. And the crowd, and I don't understand, like, you know, all of a sudden, she just going up and asking motherfuckers to shut the fuck up. It's warranting booing?
Or warranting the term arguing.
Exactly. I'm just like, oh, no, we're not about this life. So I just quickly put in, you know, I'm just like, I got to check a bitch right now, and here You got an X. We're not having this conversation.
Alrighty.
But you know,
Bernard Tomic.
Okay, let me just tell
messy.
Bernie cleaned your nose up. And I like it. I like it a lot. I know that he is a hot fucking mess, and he is always involved in the wrong things. He's, you know, fucking drag racing, getting tickets, doing drugs, you know, fucking probably prostitutes. I don't know. I'm making this shit up. I have no idea. But we know that he's always in the news for something negative. But I am saying right now, sit back, watch, and eat this shit up, because he is not pulling this out of his ass. It is coming from somewhere, and I truly believe 100% that something dirty is going down in Tennis Australia, and he's trying to put it out there, but people aren't going to want to listen because of where it's coming from, because he's the bad boy.
I disagree.
Of course I don't disagree with myself. All of
the things that Bernard Tomic said, Tennis Australia accepted as true in the sense that they are making him pay for his courts. They are doing all the things he accused them of doing, but the reasons are different. He says they're doing it just to be small. They say they're doing it to try to teach him a lesson, because in their minds, I believe they think he does not have a parent, and it is their job to parent.
But he, if you dig into what he is saying, he has essentially said that Pat Rafter is a scapegoat for shit that's going on behind the scenes. He's like, what are they doing with money? And maybe he is just a pissed off little brat, because I've been calling him a brat for years. But I just wonder if something is going on, because do you really go out there and try to start trouble like that?
Yes,
and
you say do. That
you an know, organization.
You do when you don't want to
clean your own house, and when you don't want, when you don't want to do the painful thing, which is to admit that you are coming from a personal space with whatever is going on tragically within your family. And so instead of taking ownership of that and being an adult and saying, you know what, I need to get out of a space and I need to not have my father take the lead on things because I have a conflict, they have a conflictual relationship.
Well, yes, as well.
So what you do is you go on the defensive. You attack. So that, that
sure you do, but what he is attacking is that, is there any
I don't care
if he's being petty. I don't care if he's being defensive. I care if is he talking about something that nobody wants to talk about.
I mean, if this is like saying, is the USTA spending its money wisely? We know these things don't always happen. That's, I mean, like, asking that question is like a red herring. Of course organizations don't spend their money as wisely as they should. I mean, we could say the same thing for Tennis Australia, possibly.
The real question is Tennis Australia responsible for your lack of a career?
Exactly. No.
And they're not. You know what? I'm going to go back just a tiny bit, because you know what? Now that you see, I have short-term memory. You know, I think Nick be a little bit of an asshole. But you know what, Nicholas? You don't be acting like an asshole to me. You're not that kind of an asshole. You're totally not. And you know what? Through what you have done and kind of said, you haven't been this kind of an asshole. Tomich is the kind of guy who gets involved with the police shit, and then motherfucker stays in the car and just like, you can't talk to me. You know, I'm not letting you in. I'm not letting
he's
the police
an asshole.
In. I mean, he's well, crazy.
I mean,
and
there
he
might
has
be
a lot of shit to deal with. And you know what? To me, just like, he just come off of the fact that, you know, he's in a press conference. Think of it. He just got his ass handed him by Nole, who was being rather generous.
Yes.
Okay? Who was being generous and giving you a couple of games. He couldn't deal with that shit. He couldn't talk about the fact that, you know, like, I didn't get my game on against the world.
Well, okay, so
he decided to do it unprompted. They didn't ask him shit. He was just like, you know what?
Luke, let me throw this in here real quick. Luke from Twitter, Black Skywalker, thank you very much for joining us from the pond, says, Twitter poll, is Tomic a whistleblower or a brat? And I think that's a very valid point. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Is he being a brat or is he being a whistleblower?
No, but they're not mutually exclusive.
Karen is going to give a word in for this.
Can I get a word in on this conversation?
Yes.
No.
Please.
Sometimes tennis has this tendency to shoot the messenger.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And I think in this situation, I think Tomic being the messenger is being shot. He's not a credible messenger. Yeah. That's the first thing. He really isn't because of this, of his backstory with his father and everything. But one of the things that has gotten lost in the conversation is the fact, it's something that he said about, you know, how Tennis Australia is not really spending money on its homegrown talent, i.e. Sarah Tomic, but actually going up there and spending money to buy players.
Yes.
And spending, you know, basically investing in players from other countries and giving them Australian citizenship to enable them to play for Australia. And I think that's one of the more, that's probably part of what his problem is. I don't think he has a problem in actually paying for court time or balls or anything. I think he's thinking about the fact that the money that Tennis Australia is making is not being spent on the development of Australian players.
Well, this is where Pat Rafter has come in and talked about that.
Doing with all these Russian players was taking these Russian players and putting a badge, giving them a passport. Hey, you're a Kazakh now. You know, I mean,
we've all thought that was a very valid approach when other countries do it. So why is this suddenly up for questioning? I mean, we noticeably do this in the United States. I mean, we're not that successful at going to find foreign talent, but we love a new citizen. I mean, the exact same thing has just happened with the Brits, with Badin. So, I mean, this is because we say to ourselves, if the homegrown talent isn't doing what they need to do, why not look elsewhere? So this is not something new. I mean, what I'm saying is that they're not mutually exclusive. He could be a whistleblower and
a brat.
Yes.
I believe that that's probably what's happening. And I believe that what Karen said, you know, is going to come into play big time.
Later.
He's not credible.
Later, someone. See, that's the problem. See, this is why you got to conduct yourself a little better, so that when you say things, we can
people
take
listen
seriously.
Yeah,
I was. That's
the lesson for you, Bernie. Is change yourself a little so that we can take you seriously when you blow shit up for us and tell us the deal.
Right.
You see, this is why I quote Serena right here, because you see, when you don't have an education, you see, you need to get educated.
Oh, my Lord.
You need to get... Exactly. Because...
Oh, my God.
I'm just saying.
That is really cool.
You just need to.
Oh, my God. This guy just told... Sam Bicep just said, I got defeated 6-love, 6-3. No! No!
I like that response. Let's move on. Okay. Let's talk about, are we going to talk about Spain at all?
Oh, Lord, why should we?
I just mean, go ahead.
I
want to wait for more episode than this telenovela because
I
don't know if I'm ready.
Right now.
I'm his own show.
I'm making my case similar to Karen. Similar to Karen's case. This is where I'm going to rob from Karen right now. I think there is something rotten in Denmark/Spain. And we all know...
Oh, my God, I'm sorry.
Wait, no, I'm not going to go there.
Yeah, go.
We all know that these mofos are getting old and tired, and there was not a good chance that they were going to be coming back with a sixth title with this dream team. And this is all a massive distraction for us all to freaking realize that Team A is on their way out. And this has just been this wonderful dance. Because, listen, these boys, the top team, they didn't exist. They didn't do it for Moya. And they certainly weren't going to show up for somebody who, quote, unquote, they didn't approve of. They approved of Moya. Fat good, that did them. So I just think that this has been a wonderful dance for Spain. And we've all been nicely distracted. So that by the time they take their team in July, we'll simply be grateful someone shows up.
Wait. Hold up. We gotta do this. We have to do this. The drum roll. Guess who is the Davis Cup captain?
Conchita Martinez.
I'm telling you.
Which is basically like someone dropping a bomb in the middle and saying, see, we had no problems with the vagina. She can come into the locker room all you want. Bada bing, bada bang, bada boom.
I have no country that got a balls.
We don't care.
My God.
So I'm telling you.
I found it delightful that we spent this entire time pondering Davis Cup without even talking about the fact that Feliciano Lopez is old, Roberto is old,
Granola is
old. I mean, it's like we haven't talked about the real thing that's happening actually with the team. We spent our time talking about the politics.
Exactly, so, and the history.
That's a win for you, Spain. I think you have won this PR disaster that has been created. And I thank you very much for making it a telenovela.
I'm telling you. Oh, and they got more episodes to come. That's
more
just
episodes
it's coming.
And you know what's wonderful about it? Let's look at this. And I said it earlier this week. All the top guys from Spain lost. giving them plenty of time to return to DC and become heroes again. So there you go. That's so no excuses, mofo.
Nobody try calling Roberto Aguirre.
I'm sure.
He ain't got time for that.
I'm sure you better be ready.
I'm sure Conchita Martinez has all you guys on speed dial, mm-hmm. and she called you all up, and she told you all what she expects from you. So next time around, I don't want to hear anybody say they didn't get a phone call, they didn't get an email.
She's gonna keep her appointments apparently because you know Bella. And people got mad. You're wasting my time, girl. You are wasting my time. I'm not having it on my watch.
I care about it as much as I care about my soaps, which is not very much. So
I don't even watch soap, but this is the shit. I'm telling you.
It was all a wonderful performance. And I look forward to the 10 years when we find out what was really going on though.
I know.
So
What I love is the insistence of the Spanish Tennis Federation to be like, you're getting a woman. You're getting a female captain. You are not getting some old mofo, no Carlos Moya, no Juan Carlos Ferrero, who I would have loved to see on the sidelines. No tea, no shade. You know I like me some Juan. And they're like, no. You are getting a woman.
Get Conchita. And enjoy Conchita.
And she got Fed Cup experience, just in case you think she's not good at winning playing team sport. She's all about
the
team.
I think the central question, though, does remain.
Why?
Do men play tennis like women play tennis? This is going to be really confusing for her. I don't know. You know, the balls are a different color. The courts are a different color. They don't have forehands. I don't know what people don't serve. You know, women don't serve. So I don't know what that's going to be like.
I think they might be mad.
They don't even start the games the same way. The women start at love 6. I don't know. You know, the numbers. It's all so different.
There are no time breaks.
I don't even know if she can enter the locker room because, you know, she probably has never seen a penis before. So this might be a big problem in a locker room where you maybe can put on a robe and talk. I don't know. These are the issues. These are the compelling issues.
And I look forward to the next episode when it all will be revealed. I'm telling you.
The next episode is
struggling with ratings. This is it.
Team captains.
I'm telling you. Of course, Donald Trump won't watch, but you know what? We don't give a shit. Don't worry about translation, folks. We will just get a Spanish buddy to come over.
I just took that over because I found that whole thing so tiresome. It was like a massive PR blitz that was dumb.
That's fine. Wrap that shit up. Good job, Andreen.
Thank you very much. Can I be counted, Sam Biceps, as winning that 6-1? 6-0, or the possibility of a draw because the scores are weird when you do men and women together. So
okay, so I don't want to get too serious just yet. We're gonna end, I just want to talk about, since we talk about, you know, locker rooms and coach. Can we coach from the sidelines?
Yeah, I watched.
You know,
okay, so
I got some signals for you. Can you see? Can you see my eye twitching? Can you see it? I'm giving you sign language. I need a full hand right now.
Listen,
full hand come through.
Listen, I watched JJ and her brother yesterday. That shit.
The face slap?
The face slap, the tapping, and they're doing it back and forth.
There's almost tapping that gets me.
Oh, my God. I was like, could you be any more obvious? But who was it? Crazy John McEnroe that was talking about it? That this is what you do. This is what they do. Everybody does it, but nobody wants to talk about it. Everybody has hand signals that they use with their coaches, and this is how you do coaching from the stands. Everybody fucking does it.
Not everybody does it. And
bullshit.
I don't like that. I don't think everybody does it.
Well, most people.
Not do that.
I don't think most people do it.
Venus does not do that.
You know what? I wish she would. I think there are more people.
There are more people who do than don't. Let's say that. Because there are very few players, I think, who don't interact much with their box when they're playing. Venus being one, which Venus had, she did bring a coach down one time. Remember that? It was kind of weird. It worked for her. It actually helped. I mean, I'm all for it if it works, but whatever. She doesn't do it. Serena just bitches to her box. I don't think she gets any secret hand signals. Federer, I don't even know that Federer acknowledges that anybody's sick.
Because
Federer knows they got his back. Merca got his back. You know, there is never a doubt about him. Gavin got
his back.
I have a theory about coaching from the sideline gate. Because this is tennis and there's a gate for every damn. This is my theory.
It's a fence.
And I think it has to do with the lack of interest in Djokovic.
Yes.
I think
I don't get it. I don't get it. What does that mean?
Numbers have been really low.
The first
two Grand Slams of the season in which he participated, the ratings were exceptionally low.
So
if he makes another, he has been beaten twice in terms of ratings. He played this year's Grand Slam final, right?
Yep.
Yeah,
and he lost.
He won.
He won one and lost one.
Yeah, he won this year, and his ratings were lower than the women's final.
Yes, which is always
the French Open final, and his ratings were low again then.
And he lost.
For a three-peat. So if he gets to the final, as we suspect he would, since he has nobody in his path who can stop him, if he goes up against Serena again, he's going to lose again.
Yep, no history
and if
there.
He gets to the U.S. Open final, as he probably will, he's going to, and Serena gets there, and he's going to lose again.
Because she's going to have the Grand Slam thunder. She
wins. People have no interest in Djokovic. So what better way to get buzz around your player is, one, to have your coach speculate or imply, infer.
No, he stated. There was an implication.
That your player cheats. So that gets interest. That gets lots of buzz around your player. So people will tune in to try to see whether or not player A actually cheats or gets coaching from the box. It's just a PR. It's either that or just said Boris Becker's book.
What? or both.
They're not really exclusive.
I take it for what it was, just a bunch of nonsense. It won't get me as a person who loves tennis, and even if I watch men's tennis, which I barely do, I wouldn't tune in to watch a Djokovic match anyway. Just because his game style does absolutely nothing for me.
Well, you know, the other thing too, and as an aside, can we call tennis on its desperation to be popular as an aside? Rules are rules. They're there. If you don't like them, vote on them in whatever process is available and get rid of them. However, can we not have this dialogue where, hey, if we change this rule, it'll make tennis more popular? What is the integrity of your rule then? If it is up for grabs.
Same for popular thing.
For popular. It's
just
the same
to get on TV. I'm telling you, social media tennis legends.
Yeah, it's like the same thing with the coaching. Everybody says that the thing about tennis is that it's you against another person, and that's really the integrity of tennis. Hey, wait, I hear that you might get two more points in ratings if we brought some guys on court and talked to you about it. Oh, okay. I mean, can we figure out the integrity of your sport, what matters to you, and not have it be up for discussion always about becoming more popular? Because that is essentially what someone then wanted to argue with me and say, hello, because coaching is happening on the sidelines, why don't we just let it happen? You know what? A lot of people steal, but we still say it's not a good idea.
Even though watching a robbery in progress would be
even though seeing people killed on TV might get us higher ratings, we kind of don't like killing. So let's get a backbone, tennis and tennis leadership.
Let's take ourselves seriously.
Quit chasing the proverbial eyes on TV for sponsorship or whatever the hell you're doing. Decide which rules matter. Punish the people who break the rules, and let's just move on, okay?
And
that's my rant on that shit.
Punishment would be better for ratings if you stop punishing motherfuckers.
Yes, yes. Actually, it would.
Punishment is. You see, y'all got that good old shit in 2011 when y'all tried to give Serena, when you didn't try, you give Serena $100,000 rating. Fine.
It was in every media.
I'm telling you, it was everywhere.
It made network news.
Okay, can we talk about something brand new that just came on Tennis Media on Twitter? People covering their faces with Vegemite to show their support of Wimbledon.
What? Not Wimbledon, of Nick.
Of Nick. Nick.
Not on my watch. Yeast infection. Put it in the right place.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Skywalker, for bringing it to my attention. But yeah, these motherfuckers are making their faces brown in support for Nick Kyrgios. I don't know.
Blackface. Could we all have a conversation about blackface and why that is never what we do? Lordy.
No, white people, stop it. Stop it. White people, stop it. Stop it. Australians, stop this.
Wait.
Is this actually a thing, or are you guys just making
this
shit up? No. Karen, check your Twitter right now. This shit is happening right now.
No, white people, don't.
In 2015, we have decided that the way to show support to a brown athlete is to put Vegemite on our faces instead of simply saying, "Hey, Nick, go for it."
You know, get a T-shirt. You know, go bare back. You know what I mean? We do it all the time for Andy Murray. We don't run around in a Loch Ness monster costume. We don't speak a Scottish accent.
Just get masks. Get Nick masks and put them on your face.
They make those for every athlete available. You can get a head and put it right over yours and sit in the audience and say, "Hey, I'm supporting the brown boy."
Yes, let's not use this as an opportunity to be racist as fuck.
Let's just say we're supporting Nick.
No, but you know what? Listen, let's not ignore race. I hate when people do that. Nick is not white, and it's okay for him not to be white.
Yeah.
It's okay, and it's okay for us to admit it, because guess what? We have eyes. We can see it. It's not a dirty secret. It's all right. So when we say that he's brown, we are acknowledging that he is non-white, and there is nothing wrong with that. Tennis, it's okay. You can admit color. You're not doing anything bad.
But
please, let's not paint our faces. Here's my thing. If you want to support Nick and you want to do something to your face, like, shave your eyebrows.
Dye your hair.
Cut your hair every day. Nick got a whole lot of shit he could do, okay?
Don't pick something that has such a loaded history. Or better yet, get some history. Read some books.
Yeah. Open a book.
Australia,
it's good for you.
Australia, you got your own race issues to deal with.
Don't add blackface to it. No. We don't do
it. Our brown faces, you're not going to try to tell me.
All right, honey.
Listen, bitches, it's illegal. Just cut the shit now. Just cut the fucking shit. Done.
I know that I think Nick says it, that I don't know, my favorite person on Twitter right now, Black Skywalker, saying, "I don't know what's worse, the act of blackface or the ignorant smiles that go with it." I think it might be a combination. Today, I'm all about the combo.
We're not mutually exclusive. We're
You're going to get a 2-for-1 idiot special here today.
And seriously. And food. And you put food in your face. I mean, I know nobody else in Australia doesn't want Vegemite, but I mean, seriously, it's still food. Why are you people? No. No, people. Right. We can do better.
This is not about giving yourself a facial.
No. It's all right.
All right. Anyways.
Moving on.
Do better.
Ask your black friends why that's not okay, and then listen to what they tell you. Or get a really good one, though. Not the ones that'll tell you that that's okay to do.
Actually, you don't even need your black friends. I'm telling you, it's not okay. And once I say it's not okay, it's not okay.
It's not okay.
This is why you listen to this blog, because this blog tells you what's not okay. Because
it's black people.
We're all black people. We're coming out
black people that watch tennis.
And yeah. That's one of the things that we love about ourselves is that we can watch tennis and enjoy it. Until
and you know what?
To put blackface on.
Let me just put this out there. I am half white, so I get to talk about both sides.
And I'm Jamaican, so I get to pretend that I'm not American half the time and look at the culture and go, what the hell is this? But
I'm Jamaican, born and bred. We were the innovators of the civil rights movement. Okay, we were
I don't know what just happened.
Moving on. So we're going to talk about, you know.
All right.
You know what? Bye.
That was almost too much for me to deal with. Sorry, people.
Okay. Yeah. Sometimes we get real and spiritual here, you know. So.
Because you're dealing with black.
Exactly. Time to deal with stalking.
Oh Lord, we gonna end there? Oof.
No, I don't want to end there because I got something to end on. Don't worry.
No, okay. We have questions from the audience.
Yes. Let's see what that.
Okay, let's go. What are y'all talking about? Anything? Better be good.
Yes. I did the search already, and I can't believe I lost it. So.
Okay.
Fanaticism, is that the word? I think it is. Yeah, oh my probably. God! I can read. Apart. By us, believers of Williams Sisters, we want to have Venus left with Vika, Marina, Maria, and Lucy? And this comes from Yums. You know what? That's a great question. My response to that is, if Venus can get through Serena, yeah, she's fine to get through the rest of them. I'm fine with that.
You know, my memory is rather long. I'm an elephant. And I'm going to say 2005 U.S. Open.
Thank you. I love it.
I'm going to say 2007 Wimbledon.
And I'm going to say I don't give a shit about the past. It's all about the future. We understand. We know that Serena can really realistically mow down the rest of the field if need be. But we are going to take a moment and recognize and honor the great thing
Venus
that this
is the queen.
And so we can't back down. Yes, we can't back down. She's bringing Negro spirituals into it just for that. So we can't.
Oh, Dennis TMDC says that people, not necessarily us, are forgetting Vika, and can she win Wimbledon this year?
No.
No. Quick answer, no.
No. Not with the rest of the field. No.
No.
With the rest of the field.
Bye, Vika. Yeah, we love you, girl, and I used to love Sasha when he was cute.
And Dennis, I'm gonna tell you why I said this. Why we're saying this? She might have made the semifinals twice. It's a reason she has never gone beyond that. That's the first reason. The second reason: grass court tennis requires a certain type of play, and Vika just doesn't have it.
And it requires a serve. Requires a serve.
It does. And a second one, too.
I wasn't
just a first.
Really verbalize just how poor Vika moves on grass.
Yes.
But I listened to Virginia Wade recently, and Virginia Wade is a past Wimbledon champion, so she knows how to play on this surface. And she basically gave words to what I've always thought. Hard players who are more comfortable playing on a hard court have this thing where they do adjustment steps, take small steps to get into position, to get around the ball, and that kind of thing. You've seen it before. And that's one of the things that I personally admire about Azarenka's game, her ability, the way her feet keep moving. On grass, you have to already be in that position. And this is why people like Venus is so good, because she anticipates well, she moves very well, she's quick around the court, and she's always in position for the next ball. But Azarenka, she's actually going towards the ball when it's already there. And for to win at Wimbledon, you can't do that. In addition, you also have to have a kill shot to win Wimbledon. Petra Kvitova has that huge forehand, that huge lefty serve. That's an advantage. Serena has the same thing. Sharapova has those huge flat strokes. She doesn't move as well as she did at 17, which is probably one of the reasons why she hasn't won it again. Venus, the same thing. That huge serve, big powerful forehand, the movement. That is what makes Bartoli, when she won, anticipates great, moves well off the ground, believe it or not, she moves better than Vika.
You know what?
Service.
Vika, you need to call Karen. You just found yourself a new coach.
Call Virginia. Virginia.
She needs to be better on the surface, and I don't think at 20. How old is Vika now? 26?
I don't know.
26 years old, if you haven't adapted your game to a particular surface by the time you get to this age, I don't think you will. And it's the same reason that Wozniak, even though she won this title as a junior, which is probably one of the reasons why she can't win, she can't move further than where she will probably be ending up in this tournament as well, because she will meet somebody who will be just that bit better.
Sounds good to me. I like your thoughts.
I like her thoughts. This is why we have Karen around.
This is why we have Karen. So, continuing on.
And she lets us call us greatness.
I know it. RTF Live Cash hashtag Master Ace.
Yes, it's all up in your shit again.
What's that, Karen?
Our favorite contributor. We should have him on at some point. Hey, Masters, if you're listening, you know.
Thanks for always supporting us.
Yes, and being up in Janina's shit all the time, apparently.
All the time. All right, anyways. He says, since Andy Roddick retired, we have no U.S. men that make a deep run. Quarterfinals are better. Why? Why? Because they all fucking suck.
No, and also, you know, because, to be honest, I will say that this is an identity issue for the United States. The premier voices in the U.S. tennis community spend more time trying to impress upon me why we need to imitate the Spaniards and get clay courts. And in order to retain the stars, certain stars, they slow down courts in tournaments that attract U.S. fans. So why, when the identity of U.S. tennis for so long has been serve and monster forehand, according to Patrick McEnroe, and according to tradition, I mean, yes, we don't do the Johnny Mac anymore. We don't do the serve and volleying and all of that wonderful thing. But if your game is built on, and think about all the young up-and-comers coming right now, the power game is strong for all of them, especially the women. Why would you not nurture that by making sure your courts are faster, so that when you come to North America, everybody says, whoa, we're on fast, hard courts. And I guarantee you we would see more penetration from the U.S. side.
Oh, girl, didn't you know you play hard court tennis in Spain? Didn't you know that?
No. But you know what I mean? I mean, what I'm saying is build on your strength. Use your strength. If fast, hard courts are what you do, why would you dull that down so that other people can thrive and then costing your own American players? I don't understand that. That's just as like a naive initial fan look. And that's my first impression, Master Ace, is that we have taken the thing that we are best at and tossed it aside.
You know what? I'm going to go a little deeper and say, you know what? I just never liked Andy Roddick because he fucked with Pete Sampras. My memory is rather long. Mm-hmm. But you know what? I just think Americans just never, even if you wanted to slow down the courts.
They did.
We're going to say that.
They did.
Yes, they did. But they never changed their fucking tactics with their players. They just kept them doing the same shit.
But like, it doesn't matter. Did Spain change their tactics, or did the courts change to suit their games?
But that's what I'm saying. If you're going to do that, if you're going to change slow down the courts to allow other people to thrive, why then still tell your players to do this old tactic, which doesn't work? Is it you're setting them up for failure? Full hand and a big serve. It can't work. It works nowhere. So, you know, that's my problem. It's just like either you get the courts back to be all distinct, which is what people, you know, like people have been asking you for, but apparently you want ratings and epic matches, you know, and all this bullshit, and the same set of people showing up in the finals, because, you know, that's good. You know, you can't see a stranger in the final. why not adapt the game? Because, I mean, I don't know. And I'm just going to put this out here. I just think y'all are looking in the same set of country clubs. And you need to go out in the highways and the byways and probably in the city.
I mean, because, hello, the best two players in America right now came from the ghetto. Just saying.
That you love to tell us. And you don't even go back to the ghetto to go look for more. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, if a man can sit down and decide, you know what, none of my children are athletes, and I'm going to make these last two tennis players. And he is from the hood. And he did it.
He did it.
And he did nothing traditional. He took them out of junior tennis. That you're not even trying to be like, maybe, just maybe. There might be a couple other children in the barrios, in the hood.
You might have to speak Spanish, areas, though.
You know what I mean? Like,
speak Spanish. And exactly. You can assume that they're going to play on clay, but I'm just saying.
Why isn't there another Michael Chang look-alike? Why? Rodney King?
All right. Master Ace has also asked us, who is the next USA W2A superstar after the Williams sisters are gone? Will it be Stevens, Keys, Vandeweghe? Who? You know what?
I'm looking for her to come out of South America or Mexico. America's going to buy another player.
We're going to go shopping. It'll be none of them.
I'm
looking at you, Madison. I am looking at you. Stevens, I was looking at you for a long time, and then you just kind of like went batshit crazy. I don't even know what happened. Like,
so
I
feel, I don't know.
Coco, yeah. Coco, I feel like, is going to be... She's not, I don't know. I don't feel like she's ever going to be too much of anything. I feel like she'll have her moments. I don't feel like she'll ever be extremely consistent. I don't know. I don't, it's just, you know, my thoughts.
So I'm going long haul and saying that Taylor Townsend, if given the right opportunity, Taylor Townsend could emerge as the next USA big girl.
But it's
long haul thinking. I'm thinking long term.
I like Taylor Townsend.
This is a little bit of constructive criticism.
Don't do it. Stop.
Okay. All right. It's Sunday.
Yes. So we also have a comment from Lovely Drama Girl, one of our new great people that like to talk to us on the YouTube channel, says, has anyone been watching the juniors? Quick answer for me, no.
No.
I just saw Elias, how do you say, Yamar's? Younger brother, Mikhail, advance into the next week, and I'm starting to hear one or two Swedes grumble about how they're not like our other Swedes. Mm-hmm. I hope we're not seeing the same dynamic we've had to endure with another famous tennis-winning group of siblings.
Amen!
I got nothing to say, but... Amen. And go out there, boys. Do the damn thing.
I'm just gonna say, you notice how people are uncomfortable when these people are undiluted people of color. When they got no mix in them, it's always a problem. But when they're light and bright, you know, then they could be like, I'm just saying.
Billy. That's right.
don't let us quote Paul Mooney up in here. Y'all know.
Exactly. Y'all not ready for that kind of podcast, and it's a Sunday.
But you know what? In honor of the 40th anniversary.
Oh, yes. Oh, my God. Amazing.
Drum roll, please.
Drum roll.
Of Arthur Ashe taking down Jimmy Connors.
Yes.
We made this podcast extra black.
Yes, we did.
We made it so black that even Arthur Ashe would have been like, girl, you can't say that out in public.
No,
we did it. But we did it.
And I hope we are listening to us in South Africa.
In honor of Arthur Ashe, who I have to say has... I am really pleased that the most important thing about Arthur Ashe, strangely enough, is that he was more than a tennis player. And so I am just profoundly happy that we get to talk about his legacy, not just on the court, but off the court. And I know that's, you know, it's not expected of everyone. It's not what everyone needs to do. But I'm happy that he was willing to do it and took pride in challenging all of the color lines that he encountered. And so on this day, I saw ESPN's tribute, and I got a little choked up because I thought that he was the best of us, really. And so I'm really proud that he took down Jimmy Connors in the way he took him down, because he really challenged the idea that we were brainless. And he outsmarted Jimmy Connors and took a win that nobody expected. And for me, that's that's a wonderful memory. And so as we think about the Williams sisters going up against each other, I don't know. I think Arthur Ashe would be very happy to see that that has come to pass.
Let me just say, let's not forget Althea Gibson, because I love me some Althea.
Yeah, I know, but today
is Arthur Ashe.
What about Arthur? Let's have Arthur.
you know what I found disappointing? Just the faultless year of Arthur Ashe winning, Wimbledon and,
probably got background music somewhere. What's going on?
Who's background music?
It's Janina. I know. Nobody want to tell me anything else. It's Janina.
Wait. I want to hear. What did you say?
Okay, I'm done.
Okay. Oh, my Lord.
I'm out of control.
Okay, carry it.
My dog. God, this is like a clusterfuck of epic proportions.
It's all right.
It's all right.
It's an awesome moment, sister.
We're Reels podcast.
I'm telling you.
Was the disappointment I felt in reading a press conference from one of, the tour's younger player of color.
Oh, dear.
And the fact that she, when asked about, Arthur Ashe and his contribution, could barely string two words together to describe the impact that he has had on the game and how it has affected not only, it may not have affected her, but affected, persons of color. And it's not just only her.
No.
It's today's younger players who don't really appreciate the historical importance of this particular sport.
Well, is it their fault, or is it the fault of people not teaching them?
I'm coming to that point, because I think in the same way that the WTA and ATP are quick to, have these contests to show who is the rising star and who is the next big thing and everything. And it should be mandatory for players coming onto the tour to know about the history of the sport.
Yes.
And to those who have paved the way socially, who have made real social change, from Amelie Mauresmo coming out, when it was not popular to
popular
do so.
Popular and withstanding all of the bullshit, exactly.
To Arthur Ashe, standing up for persons of color, Althea Gibson doing the same thing, Billie Jean King.
Standing up for gender and color, Althea Gibson.
Just really, putting their livelihood on the line. I mean, touring South Africa during the height of apartheid as a professional athlete was just not something that you did.
Mm-hmm.
In the West Indies, we basically just did not go to cricket. Did not go to any tournament in which South Africa played. And West Indies was a top cricketing nation at that time. And we have world-famous players who were banned for life for actually going to South Africa to play cricket. So for Arthur Ashe to do something like that...
And demand that no segregated crowd.
It took a lot of strength of character to do that, and to actually, I don't know whether when he held tennis clinics, whether persons of color were permitted to, go to these tennis clinics, and I would be disappointed.
I think it would be weird if that was the whole point.
How he felt, going into that kind of situation, that country club, and being, apart from those who basically serve food, the only person of color inside there who probably, got somebody to wait on him. how disheartening must he have felt, you know, to be in that situation, which is probably one of the reasons why he came back and probably devoted the rest of his life.
Because he saw that same shit in his country too?
Yeah, to fighting for social change and social justice. You know, and I was disappointed to read, you know, the comments or the lack of comments on a top player, you know, somebody who is pegged as the future of the sport, not really knowing anything about Arthur Ashe. I mean, I'm from Jamaica. I know everything about Arthur Ashe. Can't help. Well,
I'll tell you, outside of tennis, you know, just in general, being an American, you don't learn about the black people in schools. If your family hasn't taught you, if you don't have someone older that can mentor you and teach you about your own history, you're not going to learn about it. And that is the way of America. You get Black History Month, where every day for 28 days somebody wants to give you a little tidbit of who invented this or that. When it comes to history in the school books, you just don't learn about it. My,
what did I just see a reason about the slave revolt? You know, I'm not even going to go because I'm going to be mad. It's Sunday.
But you know, it's just, it's sad. It's sad that we don't take the opportunity to teach about everything. It has been my personal experience that, thank you, Twitter, for opening up my eyes to the world and being able to engage with people from different parts of the world. It is my own personal experience that non-Americans know my history better than I do, as far as race relations, American history in general, because we don't study it here. It's not it just isn't a fundamental part of the education system. It's not. We don't talk about it. Especially not the ugly parts. That's what needs to be talked about the most, the ugly parts, because everybody knows that if you don't know your history, you are doomed to repeat it. Everybody knows that, and nobody wants to talk about the ugly parts.
And if you ask me, really and truly, they're all ugly parts. But you know what? It's not me. You know, this is not time for me.
When we do want to talk about those things, though, we want to talk about the good stuff, the things that are glorified. But yeah, there are many people who did many things and paved the way. But let's talk about what they had to do to get there.
Those glorified moments that they talk about is where the ugly stuff really is hidden. But you know what, like I said.
No, I agree, but I'm just saying, nobody, as an American, and Karen's like, you know, we need to, it's sad that people don't know about Arthur Ashe and what he truly did, but we don't talk about it.
But it's ironic, they're going to be playing in the stadium come next week.
I know. It's so much more.
We have taken up a lot of your Sunday, and I just want to end on a little note. You know, we can talk about the other issues. I think we did really well this week. We did well this week, folks. We did really well. And are there any more questions? Because I am going to throw out a bomb, you know, and, you know, it's not going to be a serious topic. I'm just going to say, you know, I think Stan and Donovekic are fucking. You're not gonna tell me anything else. You know?
All right. Well, thanks for joining us.
I mean, it's a bad segue, but you know, we gotta end on a light note. You know,
that's the way to drop a bomb in a room. And I appreciate that bomb dropping.
And join us next week as we wrap up Wimbledon.
What a place, folks.
And that is how we'd like to end our tennis.
Yes, exactly, folks. So, you know, if you don't feel it's true, you know.
Tell us why.
Do tell you why, you know, until next week.
Hey, tweet to us.
As a matter of fact, no, I'm not going to, you know what, I want to hear your response.
Yes.
I'm just putting it out there. I know we had a Stan fan here, and she explained to us the reasons why, and I heard her. I didn't beat her down, and I listened. And, you know, like telenovela, I waited until the next episode. And a couple of episodes.
Are they fucking? Tweet to us.
Stanley But you know what? I just gotta say, Stanley, I'm not sure what's going on because, you know, you started out with a woman 10 years older than you, now it's a woman 10 years younger than you. Do you know what I mean? I guess that's how things go. You know, experience. No, you were the student before, now you're the teacher. You know?
Oh, my Lord. No. I ain't saying nothing.
Okay.
I'm just gonna wrap it up and just say it.
You know what? Thank you all for joining us at church.
We appreciate it.
Yeah. We appreciate collection.
Passing the plate.
So, what's going on? Passing the plate, folks. We thank you for enjoying spending your 2 hours with us. This is our longest podcast ever. And we really appreciate it for Middle Sunday. We're going to come back to you again next week. There might be some crazy development in the middle of the week for another half podcast.
Yeah, maybe a half podcast. If we get a surprise, get some surprises, we'll come to you middle of the week.
Tomorrow is 16 matches and it's going to be a whole manic Monday. Exactly. All round of 16s are played. And then half of those folks who want to have to come back the next day and play their quarterfinal matches. So it's going to be drama. Wimbledon always filled with drama. But, you know, thank you for listening to us. And don't forget, you can check us out on Twitter at Reels. I'm at Reels Tennis with one N.
Ah.
Fans with a Z. And Andreen is at
A underscore Gallivant, because that's what I like to do. Gallivant through your thoughts and your mind.
Oh, and your countries, too. And your countries with a tennis tournament. And Janina, you're at
JLR78.
Yes, and Karen?
At BridgeB.
Yes, tweet us. You can always email me at rtffansnewsletter, I think it is, at gmail.com.
We are such a hot mess.
YouTube comment, whatever it is. Thank you for coming, and don't forget, you heard it here first. Confirmation, in my mind, Dan McDonough's like this effective. Go Venus tomorrow. Go Venus.
Oh, damn.
Good day. Have a great Sunday, folks.